WPJ Teaching Committee, thanks to one of my mentors in the room, Bill Holbert, who's the national chairman. And by the way, anyone here in this room going to go to the National Teaching and Coaching Summit? Raise your hand if you're going to do that. Too few of you. Come on, guys. Let's do that. It's awesome. It's great. I can't tell you how not only entertaining but informative that is. Maybe not quite as informative and fun as ours, but it'll be great. Now, we've got a great day ahead of us. Before we get started, I'd like to thank a few people, naturally, who are in the room. From the section office, Sharon Kerfman, Rand Mitchell, Ariana Gomez, Nicole Quick. Let's put our hands together for them. They make this really happen. Also got a couple new faces in Bryce and Travis. You guys have seen them. Thank you guys for doing what you do. We've got Tom Addis and Jeff Johnson in the room too. You guys, the legends, thank you guys for everything you do for all of us. How about everyone? Naturally, for the staff here at Desert Willow, this has been a great venue for us for a lot of years now. Before I get started and introduce our first speaker, I want to know, who here is an A6 teaching pro? Raise your hand if you're a teaching pro exclusively. Okay, thank you. How about head pros? Directors of golf? Coaches? I know we had some coaches get in here. College and high school coaches? A couple. Who here is, how about how many summits? Anyone first summit? Raise your hand if this is your first summit. Okay, great. Anyone 25 summits? Oh, Mr. Kelly, Bill Holbert, that's great. This is about my eighth in a row. This is really awesome. I was trying to think last night of all the stuff I've been learning in all of these summits, and it's just great. It's too much to tell up here, but some point when we're having a beer, you can come and ask me, and I'll tell you everything, show you baby pictures too. All right. Again, we've got a great day ahead, and we've even got a little bonus, and I guess I'll let it out of the bag. At 3 o'clock, we've got Chris Como, who teaches a guy named Tiger Woods. He'll be here. So it's officially over if you've got other commitments, if I understand. But if you want to hang out, we've got the room afterward, and we're going to have a little Q&A with Chris Como as well. Got that last night, that call about 10 o'clock last night. Pretty good. All right, this is a Nike-sponsored event, and I'd like to introduce the North American Marketing Manager, Kyle Freeman. Put your hands together.
Say hi. Can you guys hear me all right? Start squelching. How's everybody doing?
Good.
Good morning, good morning. It's very, very, very cool to be here. As Bill said, my name is Kyle Freeman. I've been fortunate to be a part of our Green Grass staff programs for almost 13 years at Nike. And through that time, I've had some of the most incredible experiences, most notably at PGA sections, of being able to support things like this. One thing we're very proud of are the affiliations we have with many of the sections across the country, and I've been able to go to events such as this in Philadelphia, New York, and Southern Florida, and right back in our backyard in the Pacific Northwest, and this is an incredible turnout. So thank you very much for being here. It's our pleasure to sponsor this event. Definitely want to thank the Southern California PGA section. They've been fantastic to work with, as they are every year. Desert Willow, obviously, for hosting, and then, as I said, all of you for taking the time to be here and be a part of this. I think we've got some great presenters lined up, thanks to Bill and team, and, you know, it's going to be a good couple of days. Hopefully you learn a lot. As many of you know, how many would say you're familiar with Nike as a company? Not golf, just Nike. I hope everybody raised their hand. How many people have a pair of Nike shoes in your closet? Don't be golf shoes. All right, there's more hands. All right.
Hurley,
there you go. Yeah, Converse, right? Everybody had a pair of Chuck Taylors at some point in their life. You know, Nike was built on a coach and athlete relationship. And what more fitting than for us to be here today talking about teaching and talking about coaching than the genesis of Nike, which was Coach Bill Bowerman and Phil Knight. And so it's just a natural fit that this company's evolved to be the number one athletic company in the world, globally, in every category but golf. And I'll get to that in a second. But there's a reason behind that, and that's because every athlete needs a coach. They need a coach for inspiration, for instruction, for motivation. And you all, on a daily basis, work with golfers to help them get better and to help them enjoy this game and to grow this game. So having said that, as many of you have heard, recently there was a little bit of an announcement about Nike Golf. I'll say it right now, we are not getting out of the golf industry, just to be perfectly clear. We decided to strategically exit the equipment aspect of the business, but not at all in apparel, footwear, and clothes. And while it was a very difficult business decision that we made, it was made in order to be better partners to you, the Greengrass Golf Professional, to be better partners to our consumers that buy our products, and to really better innovate in what we do best as a company at Nike, which is apparel and footwear. So you're gonna see nothing more than more Nike presence in the golf world going forward on every level, from tour all the way down. We've got some exciting stuff in store for 2017, and I really hope that for those of you that support us, we greatly appreciate it. And for those that may not yet, give us a chance to win the tie. I think you're really gonna like what we have in store for this industry. We wanna make this fun again. We wanna make it enjoyable. We wanna be inclusive, not exclusive. We wanna provide products that consumers love wearing on and off the golf course. And we wanna be the best, because that's what Nike's motto is. So having said that, I wanna introduce our first speaker, who just joined the Nike family formally this year, but he's really been a Nike guy for life. One of Golf Digest's top upcoming teachers in the country, coaches some of the more prominent PGA Tour players, including Tony Finau, his own brother, which if you can coach your own brother and not have a total just meltdown right on the range, you gotta be pretty good at what you do. Really excited to have him here. Great Nike ambassador. Please put your hands together. Welcome Mr. Boyd Summerhays.
Can you guys hear me okay?
Oh yeah,
that's perfect. Thanks Kyle, I really appreciate it. I was really excited when Kyle gave me a call a couple months ago, being a part of the Nike family and being an ambassador for Nike, when he called me up and told me I'd have the opportunity to come to the Southern California PGA section and present to you all a little bit about my experience and what I've learned and how I failed, how I've learned from some failures. I was really excited to be here. I don't know many of you here today. I met a couple familiar faces from playing in the past and being at tournaments, but being that we're all in the golf business, we have a lot in common. We've been tortured by this game. We've had success in this game, joys and highs, lows. We've all probably vowed to never play the game again. Walk away, at least raise your hand if you ever vowed you're never gonna play again.
Yesterday.
Right, and that's been me too. And here I am, I'm 37 years old. I started playing tournament golf when I was five, so 32 years and I still can't give this game up because it was passed on to me from my father. So I'm honored to be here with you guys today. I wanna learn from you all today as well. I know that I'm young for being an instructor. I have a lot to learn, and I've always been an inquisitive person. Always asked why. Drove my parents nuts as a kid. Why? And I've always tried to ask other instructors what they feel like they do best, and I would love to, you know, have your input today. Feel like you can ask questions, be interactive. I want to, you know, I'm prepared in a lot of different areas for today, but I also want to kind of go where some of you feel like you would like some insights or some help or just an opinion. Tell you just a little bit about myself. Like I said, I'm 37 years old. I've been married. I'm going on 17 years of marriage. I have three kids, 14-year-old boy, 12-year-old daughter, and 9-year-old son, who all love to play the game. That's how I started playing the game. My dad was an avid golfer. He played at the University of Utah. His father was the head golf coach at the University of Utah and the head baseball coach. So we were around athletics. My dad was. And to this day, 7 years old, he's still playing 4 days a week. He plays with my uncle, Bruce Summerhays, that some of you may have met and played with or in the golf industry. Played on the Champions Tour for about 12, 13 years. And before he went on the Champions Tour, he was a life head pro. He was at the same in the same area for 25, 30 years, teaching, being a head professional, and gave his life to the game and passed that on to his kids. One of his daughters went on to play the LPGA Tour and two play professionally and still are head pros and teaching the game now. So to be honest with you, I honestly never imagined I would be sitting here talking about golf instruction in front of you today. I never imagined it. That would have never been something I thought that would happen. I grew up, like I said, in a big family, one of seven kids. My older siblings were golfers, played college golf. I would get dragged along to the tournaments. I love the game, but my parents put me in the tournament so they wouldn't have to watch me. How many of you have played for competitive golf, and when did you start? How old were you? What's the youngest?
Nine.
You started playing tournament golf?
9, 10.
9, 10, 13. What's the latest that someone started playing?
21.
Awesome. So I was 5 years old, tagging along with my siblings and started playing competitive golf. And by the time I was 8, I started to know that I was good. I came down in this area every year to play in Junior Worlds. When I was 6 years old, the first time I ever saw Tiger Woods, he was at Presidio Hills. Has anyone played Presidio Hills? National, we call it. Teeny little par 3 golf course. And we drove down there, my parents were like, we came down for this, for the Junior Worlds, to this little course that you can see from one spot. And I remember, I'll never forget, just seeing Tiger with this big Tiger t-shirt. And he already was, you know, famous. And when I was 8 years old, I took fourth place at Junior World. When I was 10, I won. When I was 14, I won again. And when I was 16, I won at Torrey Pines. And that propelled me to become the number one player in the nation. And I was a four-time AJGA Junior All-American. Wait, I'll start telling the truth too here in a little bit. But and I tell you these things because I don't play for a living. I didn't have a successful career. But leading up to that, so I was a four-time AJGA All-American, went to Oklahoma State. My roommate was Charles Howell III. Teammates were Bo Van Pelt, Ed Lohr. So I was going to play on the tour in my mind. That's all I ever thought I was going to do. And I did. I got my tour card when I was 24. And the next 12 years, or the next 10 years after I got my tour card, were basically a real big disappointment. We got the internet age. You can go look. I didn't make any money hardly. Made a few cuts is all. Had a lot of failures on the PGA Tour. I had glimmers of hope. I played in some tournaments, win some state opens. You know, after I lost my PGA Tour status, I was on a medical for 3 years. And by 2006, I lost my PGA Tour status. Regained through the Q School my web status. But lost that, and then for the next six years, just played the mini tours, played PGA Tour Canada, and I had several injuries, and that became like a part of my story. Like in Utah, our family's well known. My brother plays on the PGA Tour, Daniel Summerhays. You know, my uncle was well known in Utah. My father was head of the Utah Junior Golf Association. And I think a lot of people started to tell my story that I didn't succeed on the PGA Tour because of injuries. And there's so many people on the PGA Tour. They're banged up, injured, and they come back and they play well. And in 2012, I knew I didn't have any game anymore. I knew it was done. I wasn't getting the results. I still wanted to play, but I just couldn't get the results. And the honest truth was, is in my journey of professional golf, I went from a kid that had a lot of success, and even all the way into my early 20s when I got on the PGA Tour. But from there, from when I had the injuries, I began to have rabbit ears. I tried to change everything about my swing. I went to, I mean, not as many people that are here today, but pretty close. In a 12-year span, like for some reason, something inside me felt like there was a secret out there, and I was chasing it, and I was impatient. I'd go see an instructor, and I'd try what they told me for a couple of days, a couple of weeks, and then if it didn't work, I was on to the next, on to the next, on to the next. And how many of you are, a bunch of you raised your hands that are teachers, right? Raise your hands again who are solely basically teachers. How many times do we get a student where we can feel like they're expecting a miracle? Or their expectations are probably a little bit unreasonable. Raise your hand if you felt that before in the last couple months even. It happens all the time, right? And I was that guy. I was that guy that was looking for a miracle. Became a perfectionist, was filming my swing like every single swing during practice sessions. Mind you, I was always filming from down the line. I never was even filming from face on. You know, I was just like it was just a weird thing for someone that had so much success in golf and you know, had some promise for a future in golf playing it. You know, I really honestly lost my way. And I would say that the desire to have the perfect swing, the desire to look like other players in certain positions put me down a crazy path that I'd literally lost my game. And I knew I was done in 2012, and I stopped playing. And I only share that story about how I grew up and some of the successes I had and then the failures I have, because I feel like because of those failures, I mean, it stings a little bit to have had the success I had, to have the expectations I had. When I made the PGA Tour, I signed a 3-year deal with a big company that showed that they believed in me, and I flat out failed. You can look at the, I think I made like 4 cuts or something like that on the PGA Tour. You know, no better than a 25th place finish. Didn't have success out there, and there was reasons for it. It was not the injuries, it was that I chased perfection. I got to the point where over the ball, like I couldn't even remember like what I was thinking about the day before. How many of you have been like switching like swing thoughts and like swing theories like every day or every week? Any of you been there, or is it just me?
Every ball.
What's that?
Every ball.
Right, yeah. I mean, it gets to that point, right?
2 in the same swing sometimes.
Right. So when I stopped playing, I had to be really honest with myself. I had to be humble and realize, you know what, I kind of got tired of people telling my story that I didn't have success because of the injuries. I'd see it in the newspaper articles when I stopped playing in Utah. And I finally called up one of the reporters and I said, hey, that's not my story. My story is I lost my way. I had some injuries, but people come back from injuries all the time. I went down the road of perfectionism. I went down the road of trying to match. I mean, I was copying Tiger Woods' swing, for crying out loud. I had never been across the line in my life. And here I was, like, had a big frame by frame in my house of each frame. And Tiger, you know, he went to Butch and he kind of got away from getting across the line. He kind of just kind of took his left arm away from his body, and it just kind of made it look a little bit more down the line. Well, I was trying to copy every single position that Tiger was in because I was trying to copy the best player in the world. And so within, you know, a year, this fell down the line to me. I was like laid off, wide open, and I was hitting it dead to the right. You know, the face was wide open. And I was trying my best, not knowing that Tiger, his whole life had been shut across. So when he went outside and felt like the face open, it was making it just perfect at the top for him. And so I share that because I think that some of the successes I've had as a teacher, because like that pain of like failing so bad as a player, like it always will remain with me. And when I work with teachers or players, I try to change what needs to be changed, not what looks like should be changed. And sometimes that's easier said than done, and everyone has their own style, right? Like I think that we have to be who we are. We're not looking to teach everybody. We're trying to be a fit for people. But I'm very honest when I pitch myself to people that, hey, you know, I see the swing only in a technical sense, but I may say it in a way that seems very non-technical because I went down that road of hearing some massive words I truly didn't even understand. And I had so many thoughts in my head that I couldn't play anymore. I couldn't course manage. I couldn't like hit a shot anymore. And then the other thing I would say too that I did is I tried to, when I got on the PGA Tour for some reason, you know, most people that are rookies out there, they don't do that great. I mean, some do. It's getting better with the way the system is with web.com. But my brother lost his card after his first year. There's a lot of people that did. Like, I panicked. I just flat panicked. Like, if I got to the tour, I had to have had something good about my swing, right? I had to have had something good about my game. And I just panicked. I changed everything. Instead of just kind of like seeing, having a better knowledge of the game. And I'll talk a little bit about that today. It's just, you know, how people progress and how we make incremental improvement. I've worked with, you know, Tony Finau now for 3 years. His swing looks really different now than it used to. But like, if you looked at it like week to week and month to month, it was like, you know, unless you were his friend or you were playing with him all the time, you wouldn't even really know, right? And I was changing my swing, like it looked dramatically different every day. And I know that sometimes, when we teach, so the main gist is that because of me going down the road of perfectionism killed, I've always tried to keep it simple. Not meaning like, I don't think the golf swing is simple by any means. Like does anyone here think the golf swing is simple? Like the golf swing itself. Not meaning that we can't explain it simply or go about it simply, but to me, there's a lot of factors going in the golf swing. I mean, some people have a longer right leg, shorter left leg. Vice versa, they have physical disabilities, you got to match equipment, you've got uneven lies. The best players in the world can only hit the fairway 60% of the time, it's 33 yards wide. It's a challenging game. But I do think that we'll be better teachers if we can take complex subjects and make them simple. So I want to kind of go over, and the reason why, I want to show a couple pictures of what I'm talking about, the perfectionism kills. I was self-conscious. Whoever has looked at their swing and like liked it, like you looked at it and said, damn, that's a good swing. No, I mean, for real. How many of you? Like, be honest, if you do think you got it, okay, good.
If I take the ball away, it looks pretty good.
Okay. No, but be honest with me. Like, who thinks they have a good swing? When they look at it, like, they can appreciate it. Okay? I would raise my hand now. When I look at my swing, I can appreciate my swing now. I couldn't then, but I can now. Okay? So, and now how many look at your swing and you, like, want to vomit? Okay, it's a tricky thing, right? Go ahead.
Can I say one thing? I can remember this clear as day. I have no void. I was in the PGA Utah section for 10 years. I can remember you watching you stopping practicing, warming up for the Utah Open, the one you won, I believe, at Alpine.
Yeah.
And sitting there just, and I knew you. I knew some of the scores you shot, some of the course records you had, and you were just that. You were fantastic. And your story does need to be told. It's a great story. But I can still remember you watching you hit balls and thinking to myself, this guy's got it. And I watched you in Idaho once, and I was there. And I was like, this guy's got it. Then you got your card. I was right about that time. Man.
That's when shit started to pan
out. So go back in time. You know what I'm going to say? This. I also saw you when you were struggling.
Yeah.
Because I caddied for Ryan Yip in that tour school.
Yeah.
You did one round.
Yeah, bone on.
You were these weak cuts. Looked like you're trying to take the left side of the course out of play.
Oh, it was taking it out
of play?
Yeah, it was going right, wasn't it?
So you were hitting these weak cuts, and I could tell you were just not the same guy. The mood just looked totally different.
Yeah.
So.
And hey, I appreciate you sharing that because that's the truth. Like, I had heard that. I'd seen that in magazines. I had Johnny Miller say certain things over the air about what he thought I would do, and other players, and all my contemporaries, Nick Watney, Bryce Mulder, Sergio, Sean O'Hare. These guys were David Gossett, people that I was beating consistently. Charles Howell, we were both very good as juniors and college players. But yeah, I definitely had lost my way. It was almost not recognizable. And I appreciate you sharing that because that's the truth. But what I think it did to me as a teacher too, though, is I feel like a student, like one of the biggest things about the learning experience is they feel like you're not above them. Mutual respect is like my biggest thing. I feel like in business or anything, but in teaching, if the student feels like you're not better than them, and I can definitely feel the student's pain. When they're coming to me and they're struggling with their game, I'm not thinking, get your stuff together. This, just do what I'm telling you to do. I mean, I've been humbled. This game has humbled me to the point where, you know, I listen, I understand, I have that empathy. I still have that, you know, I'm happy now. I love teaching. Coaching is the next closest thing to playing. In some ways, man, I don't miss having to deal with that stress. You know, there's some things that I don't miss about playing that I love about coaching that I couldn't enjoy as a player. But I want to show you some of the things I do, because I was a self-conscious player. I was never a self-conscious player until I was 25 years old. I didn't really care what it looked like. I'd look at my swing and be like, yeah, it's a little laid off, but you know, I'm hitting the shot I want. Like, I was stubborn. I listened to information. I stayed with people longer. I looked at coaches as like my guides, not like I gave them 100% rein. And I don't want 100% rein when I work with a student either. A little bit more when it's like a junior golfer or a beginner, you know, but as they start to develop and they get to single digit handicaps and your little scratch golfers, I think that it starts to be more of a much more of a partnership, and you're guiding them along the path. But some of the most, I mean, who can you think of when you look at, when we're talking about not looking like every position's perfect, who are some of the players that come to mind to you guys? Jim Furyk. Okay, Ryan Moore.
Miller Barber. Trevino.
Miller Barber, Trevino, Arnold Palmer. I mean, let's keep going for a little bit, like for real. Like, I mean, I can only think of a couple of people when you really honestly, like, walk down the range, like in live motion, Like, people's swings will look pretty, but when you start to slow them down, you can nitpick anybody. You can see Jason Day's coming down with a bent left arm, and it eventually straightens, and it's a little less bent than it used to be, but like, if you slow it down, it doesn't look the same. Rory's swing, very unique. You know, it's a little different now, but you get down to impact, his hips were open, they'd recoil back, and then they come back forward. You know, it doesn't do that as much now, but he was winning tournaments doing that, right? Dustin Johnson. I had a conversation with a teacher that was in the top 50 at the time. He doesn't teach anymore. And I'm not saying that because of what he told me, but we had a discussion. I was there to work on my game. He said, man, Dustin Johnson would be such a better player if he wasn't like this. And I was already like pretty aware that I had made some huge mistakes in my playing career, and I was thinking, how the hell would Dustin even hit it if he changed that? Like, he hits the tightest. Who's sat right behind Dustin, like, live and seen how tight his ball flight is? I mean, how tight is that? Like, why would you even change that? Like, there's nothing to change. He hits a teeny draw, he hits a teeny fade when he wants, he hits it straight up in the air. There's some teeny limitations with some of the short game stuff. Used to be, because he was so shut, he didn't have as much time to use the bounce. But he sure figured that out. Like, on tour this year, from 50 to 60 yards, he was the number one or two guy on tour. So instead of, and you have to be careful, right? Because think about it, if all of a sudden you change, like say Dustin Johnson had a bad bunker game and all of a sudden you had him start rolling the face open and he practiced that over and over and over and over, what would happen with his long swing? Would he maybe stop being less boat, right? Who knows, right? If you change certain aspects of his game. Jim Furyk was mentioned. Jordan Spieth. I mean, how many times do we get a student that says, man, I hate my alligator arm, my chicken arm, my chicken wing. Jordan Spieth's got a huge chicken wing. That's how he squares the club. You know, that's how he pulls the face off. When we're looking at really unique people, we're back on, yeah, we're going live on you, okay? Okay, perfect. There's Jordan Spieth, for an example, okay? And I do this with my students. I take the time. When I was a younger teacher, I got some advice from, you know, a mentor to charge a certain amount because I played on the tour and it was too much. I was charging too much because I could tell because I was like over coaching. I was trying to get too much information in an hour's lesson. How many of us have done that where we're like trying to get way too much in there? I mean, I was really guilty of that. Like, and it was out of good intentions. Like, genuinely, all I wanted to do was help the person. I just wanted to help them. But I started to realize kind of the psychology of teaching and like the price point we price ourselves is like so critical. Like, if we're the type that says like, hey, you know, I charge $150 an hour, but hey, I'll do it for $115. You're not comfortable with $150. You shouldn't be charging $150 unless you're trying to give them a deal or whatever. But my point was that I was really over-coaching and getting so much information, even at the start, to where, you know, the more simple I could make it, the better. And I tried to slow down and like tried to teach what I believe and teach what my philosophy was to my students instead of getting in such a rush for the initial diagnosis or for the initial, you know, start of the lesson. So when I, especially when I work with junior golfers, I don't want a junior golfer to be self-conscious about their swing. Like in life, it's like I have some really good qualities. I think I'm 80% good and I'm like 20% like bad. You know, some things I just don't like about myself. But I feel good about myself because, yeah, I'm a different person than I was 10, 15 years ago. I was pretty down, you know, at that point. I let the golf kind of internalize me, beat me down a little bit. But as far as like a golf swing, like everybody had, you know, these kids, how many junior golfers do you see just sitting on the range, counting ball after ball and like working on every single position? How many times do you see that? A lot. And to me, I want students that can look at a swing and say, hey, yeah, that looks pretty good. I'm a little off. And because I'm off a little bit, this is probably going to be my ball flight. And I've got one day before my tournament, so I'm probably not even going to fix it before then. What do you think, coach? What do we do? Let's think about that course. Which side of the course, you know, am I going to stay away from? Which holes are going to hurt me? Like, empower your junior golfers to not get self-conscious. So I'll start, and I'll show them, hey, who's some of your favorite players? And I have a lot of pictures on file. You know, there's Henrik Stenson, a cupped left wrist at the top. Well, he has a strong left grip, so I'm not saying he's really cupped, he's not open. But I don't get tied into, because of the perfectionism I did have, I don't get tied into like the left wrist is supposed to be somewhere at the top on this guy, it's supposed to be somewhere else with another, right? With a lot of factors. There's Dustin Johnson, that's so telling right there. It's, as one of my students on the web.com says, that's so shut, it's open. You know, that's what he said. I mean, literally, it's like almost open. Henrik Stenson has a really unique trigger to start his swing, right? He kind of shifts all into that right leg right before he hits. His hands are way ahead, and he kind of just leans this way and gets going. Incredible ball striker. I've, you know, seen it up close. Hunter Mahan, great ball striker. That's a... Have you guys seen a lower exit point than that? Not textbook. He's an incredible ball striker. And this is when he was playing really good. John Rahm, up and comer. Everyone's hearing about John Rahm. He's playing great. Very similar, different than Dustin Johnson, but very, you know, very unique, right? So anyway, I'll show my students these things. I'll see a junior golfer with a bowed wrist. The parent says, oh, he's got a bowed wrist. And I said, yeah, so is this person, this person, this person. We got to put enough knowledge in our minds, watch enough swings, not to like dissect them all the time, but to be able to say, hey, you know, I don't have to necessarily change that. This guy plays great out of this position. If you have enough swings in your minds and enough positions of successful players, you may not go down a road of changing something that doesn't need to be changed. You know, how many times have we changed something that probably didn't need to be changed and later we thought, oh, crap. I mean, we've all done that, right? We've all done that. And so I like showing those pictures. I like having them on my memory bank. I like having them on my iPad so when I'm teaching, I can think, oh, hey, this kid, you know, doesn't need to change this necessarily because there's successful guys on the tour that are hitting the ball great with similar positions. So who was taught here the line? Has anyone taught more than 15 years here? Okay. 20 years. Okay, here we go. 25. Okay, 30. 35. 40. Okay, can I ask you a question?
Sure.
The longer you've taught... Well, first off, I do take seriously like asking people, what do you feel like has made you a successful teacher? What helps you in teaching? But you taught for 40 years. Do you teach different than you did when you first started?
Evans, yes.
Yeah, yeah, me too. And I'm like 5 years into it. There's other years where, you know, when I had injuries, I would teach players and stuff, but I'm young. I'm still growing and learning. 40 years, what's some of the things you've taken away from teaching for 40 years?
Every student is different. Yeah. You got to understand their physical capabilities or disabilities first. How do they get started in the game? What's important in the game to them?
Yeah.
And are they just interested in improving their swing or improving their score? I mean, there's so many different aspects, as you know, boy. That's the true beauty of teaching, yeah, is that everybody's unique. Everybody's a different student.
Now, I love that answer. Thank you, because... Well, something I learned from one of the instructors I went to is Sean Foley, and I went out to see him. I was struggling, looking for that quick fix. And he didn't say anything to me for like 20 minutes. He said something to me. We were just talking. He was asking tons of questions. It took him 20 minutes to finally give me a suggestion. Everybody's different. You got to get to know your student. And everybody's looking for something different. I teach, you know, players on tour. I travel every other week, sometimes every third week, but about 15 to 18 events a year. But I've never, in my vision and my mission for my teaching, I never wanted to be on the road every week. The players I teach, they already know that. If they want something like that, it's not going to work with me because I love teaching at home. I love teaching the everyday guy. And it's fascinating that everybody is looking for something different. And some of them literally are okay with, they just want to change their golf swing. They literally don't even care if they really shoot that much lower, right? Some of them know they have a terrible short game and they don't even want to work on it. So you go where the student wants to go. There's a person paying you. We're definitely in the service business. And it's all about the student. It's all about what they want. I show this picture. Thanks for sharing. Anyone else? The 35-year experience, guys. Do you teach more complicated or more simple the longer you went? What do you think?
Simple.
Yeah. And I'm not saying the golf swing is simple. It is not simple at all. You know, it's complicated, it's intricate, it's fascinating. But that's what I found, that the more I taught, the more confident I got, and the more mistakes I made. I thought, whoa, holy cow, you are talking way too much. There's no way they could be digesting it. Sometimes we feel like we know our information so well, we assume that the person listening understands it the same way. And that's like, you're going to be presenting after me, and you're a scientist, right?
Yes.
You know your shit. It makes perfect sense to you, right?
I beg your pardon.
And if you talk to me, it will take me longer to understand it, right? You're going to have to, like, take me along step by step a little bit more, right?
Absolutely.
And I think sometimes we get in lessons, and our genuine desire to help people, and it's hard. Most of you, you guys do half-an-hour lessons, hour lessons, two-hour lessons. What's the average length of time? Hour? 45 minutes. I used to think, you know, why would anyone do a half-an-hour lesson, 45-minute lesson? Well, now I kind of get it. It's like, it's just long enough to help them simply, right? And a lot of them, what are they looking for? Like, give me some things where, what are the most common things? Because to be successful as a teacher, like I never envisioned I was going to teach in general. But once I started to teach, my goal was never to teach on the PGA Tour. I just traveled. I just got my tail kicked in. I was happy to be home. My goal was to be helping people as much as I could in the right there where I taught. I wanted to kind of just own your own backyard, basically. That's all my goal was. It wasn't to be the best teacher in Utah, best teacher in Arizona. It was like, okay, I know a certain amount of people that are coming to this golf course. Let's help these people first, and let's just go from there. Let's just see what happens, you know? When people come to you, what's some of the most common things they want you to fix?
It's always a mechanical action.
Okay.
It's never, the way I teach it is a mental, visual, and mechanical action. So they always tell me about this or this body part. It's always a body part of mechanical action. It's never what they're thinking or what they're looking for.
Right. Okay. So it's a flaw in their swing. Okay. Well, any others? What do you hear? What's most of advertising about?
Distance.
Right. I get that all the time. From the tour pros. And the reason why it actually is super super important is you know, in all the other sports. Golf is finally catching up with the analytics of the game, right? I have a saying, I say drive for dough, putt for dough, because when my brother drives it good, when Tony drives it good, when Dustin Johnson drives it good, Rory drives it good, you know, there's some great drivers of the ball, they have great success. A lot of amateurs are just not good off the tee, right? And if they can add distance, not because you're gonna take a 50, 60-year-old player and make them swing faster necessarily, but we know there's a lot of components that we don't have to change their miles per hour at all to get them to hit 10, 15 yards further based on, you know, club face, you know, an impact, angle of attack, the spin, centerness of hit, a lot of factors that they don't even have to gain speed in their minds. What's the number one component to distance, or what's sometimes the only thing they think is to distance?
Force,
speed, right? Miles per hour. When I was 16, my dad got me this little device that measured club head speed, and I would just wail away, right? I just figured the higher I got that, and it was a good thing, because I do teach junior golfers to swing hard. You know, the game is changing. The harder you hit it, the higher you hit it, it makes it a little easier. I didn't understand ball speed. So when you're educating your students, what are the main factors that contribute to ball speed? Because I think to be a good teacher, we gotta be good in the aspects that are the most common. I see distance as one of them, fix a slice, chunks and fins. What are a couple of others? I mean, you got short game, right? Sometimes I get the, this was really common a couple years ago. I don't want to be the worst in the group. This goes along with what you're saying. Everyone wants something different. They just don't want to be the worst guy or be embarrassing when they go to the company thing, right? The least common request I've ever had is I want to rehaul my swing. In my experience, maybe it's different for you guys. How many is that the most common with, that they want to completely rehaul it? You get it once in a while. But in general, the guy that's coming to you, what's the average handicap of the guys we're teaching for the most part? What do you think? 14, 20, 10. How much time are they really practicing? They never practice, right? My kids swim, and they do piano, they did karate at one time, they did baseball. The only time they practice were in the lessons, you know? We got to keep it simple because we know for the most part they're not going to be practicing. But I ask those questions, okay? So those are some of the main areas that we'll get asked about. Fix a mechanical thing, usually it's a slice. Most golfers slice. Contact is really difficult for people. If they can't make good contact, I don't even start with a slice. You figure out how to get the back of the ball to the low point first. But I think the start of the lesson goes along with what you're saying. Everyone wants something different. Some of the questions that I ask, I do the same lesson every time. Whether it's a junior golfer, it's Tony meeting him for the first time on the range. Why are you here? You know, how did you hear me about it? Why are you here? Tony gave me a call 3 years ago and said, "Hey, Boyd, I'd like to talk to you." He said, "I want to talk to you about my game." So I said, "Okay, great. Let's meet over where I teach." And I didn't know whether he was going to bring his clubs or whatever. I didn't know whether he wanted advice of what he should do. He was early on his web.com season. And I said, "Hey, why are you here?" He goes, "Well, I was in..." So you get them talking, right? We're in the service business. The more they talk, the more information we get, right? Like, I want my students, like, talking, like, the whole time, for the most part. Besides the technical information I give them, I want them talking to me a lot so that I feel like I'm getting to know really what they need. You know, and Tony flat out just said, "Hey, I got in contention in North Carolina. There's some tight pins on the back nine. My ball's just spinning way too much. I can't, you know, I have to play away from everything, you know, over a tight bunker or a hazard. Like, I can't trust that it's not going to shoot up on me, and so I'm having to bail along. He couldn't control his spin." So once he tells me that, I'm not looking at his swing to say, "Wow, there's some really unique things of what Tony does still and what he used to do." But I'm not looking at changing things. I'm only looking at the things I want to change to be able to take his spin off the ball. Give him first what he needs. Get the spin off his ball, get a little bit of curve off his ball so he can control it. I always ask, what part of your game is holding you back? What do you want to get out of lessons? What's your contact pattern? I say contact pattern even before ball flight pattern, because I think as we teach players, it's sometimes hard to stay in control of the lesson. And those are some of the things I want to share today. It's like, how many times do the student, it's not even a good player yet, they're 20 handicap, 30 handicap sometimes, hits an amazing shot, and that's the shot that makes them love the game. And then the next one, they hit a bad one, they say, what did I do? And I'm honest, I said, "Well, there's a lot of things you did, you know? There's a lot of things. But there's three levels of ball striking. I think it's a simple way of explaining it. First, you hit the ball every time. If someone, you know, can't hit the ball every time, like, it doesn't matter if they chunk it, top it, whatever. First, just, they gotta be able to hit the ball. Then the next step, and most of those people, we get through that pretty quick. Next one is hit the back of the ball and go in the air. It doesn't matter, hook, slices, you know, low, whatever. Hit the back of the ball and get in the air. And the last level, which so even few tour players have, is hit the back of the ball and get the ball to do exactly what you want. You know, and sometimes by phrasing it that way, it like keeps the student like from taking all these steps, from trying to go from a 20 handicap to a plus two in a lesson. Like, I saw this little sign outside of one of this instructor's office, and he said, and it rang true to me, and it helped me start to stop over-teaching. He said, "If you expect a miracle, my rate is $10,000 an hour." That made sense, and I it made sense to me, because you can imagine over like a 12-year period of playing pro golf how much money I spent, right? I spent so much money on my game, equipment, travel, coaching, training, caddies. I would pay $10,000 an hour if I honestly knew it was going to fix me, right? But that's not a reasonable expectation. Sometimes we kind of get that feel from some students that, you know, we want to manage those expectations. I think you have to get results in your first lesson. That's why they're there. I'm a big believer in that, that you captivate somebody by getting results in the first lesson. But, you know, the true progress comes over time, incrementally. Always ask about their physical limitations, how much do they practice and play, any other sports, and I always ask them, which shot do you fear, or which side of the golf course do you fear? That question, and I only ask that because I got in a discussion with a friend of mine that was teaching the same golf course as me, and I'm always asking people, I always think I can learn something. I said, "Hey, you know, what do you think about my swing?" I said, "I fear right." He goes, "No, you don't, boy." I said, yeah, I do. You just told me I was hitting dead ass right every time, right? Yeah, bad. I used to be long. I used to have 118, 119 ball speed, or club head speed, hit the ball a mile. I remember Kevin Na, after I started to hit the weak right shot, he's like, he wasn't being a jerk. He's like, what happened? I'm like, oh my gosh, if I knew, I don't know. But basically, I don't know where I was going with that. What was I saying right before that? Sorry. Oh, which pair? Yeah. So my friend, he's like, you don't fear right. You're tired of hitting it right, but Tiger Woods, which direction did he always miss it? Right. But which place did he really miss? Fear. Fear left. Right? So then that made, opened my mind. I was like, boy, what part of your swing contributes to the possibility that it's going to go left? If the face was square, obviously my face is open at impact and it's going to the right, but why am I having to open it right down at the ball? Later I learned, oh my gosh, my angle of attack was so steep that if I kept it square, it literally would drive it into the ground. And I'm a tour pro, or had played on tour. I'm not going to drive the ball into the ground. I'm going to open that face right before impact, and it's going to go short right. You're probably really nice and help me find my golf ball today, so I appreciate that. But does that make sense? I always ask, what do you fear? And that sounds like a weird question, but Tony told me. He's like, I fear left. And so I know he fears left. I know he's spinning it too much. And so you're going to take a look at his swing, okay? So the questions we ask, to me, simplify the teaching. And you can't rush those questions. Any other questions that I missed out of those that you feel like are helpful? What other questions do you guys ask?
Other sports you've played, books you've read, past lesson experience, just to name.
Okay, now that's great, past lesson experience. Another question, sometimes I'll ask, hey, how often do you look at your swing on film? I want to know what I'm dealing with, right? Which direction I'm going. What other questions you guys feel like help you get to know the student, or where it's going to help you lead?
What do you do for a living?
Yeah, awesome. Yep. Once again, it's making it about them, but you also get to know a lot about the way their minds work and how you're probably going to give them the information based on what they do for a living, right? When I teach a couple of guys that are in computer science, and the more they understand things, they want it packaged differently, right? And then you got a guy that's a drummer that is he wants you to put you in a position. He wants you to show you some pictures of what it's supposed to resemble, or what it's supposed to feel or demonstrate, right? Mm-hmm. Well, any other questions?
What are you trying to do?
Yeah, what are you trying to do? Yeah.
About what's your best score ever and when was it?
That's great.
How did you feel?
Sorry,
go ahead.
I was going to say, ask them to be the teacher for a couple seconds. Tell them, you teach me what they're trying to do.
Yeah, I like that. That's really good. That goes along a lot with communication, where someone says, yeah, I'm flipping the club. That means four different things to me, five different things to me. That could mean, and then when you ask someone to say, what are you working on? They'd inevitably say, okay, I fight coming over the top, I flip it. This could mean, to me, from my teaching experience, this could mean flip, roll in the face. Often this is flip to them, right? Even casting would feel like flip. There's a lot of different things that we call. I have a tour player that says dumping it. And so I say, hey, I call it dumping. I use his words, right? He dumps it, flip. But in my mind, that's totally different. Someone could be the hands ahead, hit the ball's hit, face rotates, it's the ball's gone anyway. It's whatever. I like that. So this, with all these questions, I felt like when I first started teaching, I was crunched for time. And I'd watch him hit, and I was just getting right into it. But I never really miss any of those questions anymore. Does that make sense? Do most of you ask a lot of questions? Or can you see why it would be helpful? And the other reason why I like to ask questions is because it starts to build a relationship, basically. You're asking all about them, you're getting to know them, because inevitably in instruction, I feel like I've been fired and hired so many times from tour guys. I'm thinking, honey, I think I'm fired. She's like, you got fired, honey. You said that like 4 months ago, you know. You're fine. You're like, I don't know. But the more you have a relationship with somebody, like the teaching experience and the length of time you teach people increases based on a relationship, right? So that being said, when I look at someone's swing, I've kind of resigned myself to the fact I will tell them flat out. I will say, and I'm given the same lesson every time. I said, hey, well, inevitably when we look at this swing, we pull someone's swing up, and I tell them, I say, okay, I'm going to talk out loud. I'm going to tell you everything I see, and at the end of this, we're going to pick one main in-swing priority, and I'm going to give you all the setup adjustments. I don't consider, like, if I give them, you know, some multiple, you know, setup adjustments and then an in-swing thing, that it's too much, right? Those are two separate parts to me. I don't feel like that's three things if I alter a little bit in their tilt or the ball position and then give them an in-swing thought or thing to work on. And the only reason why I go step by step because I feel like when I was given too much, I worked on so much that I didn't even know really what was helping or not. Like if you're a scientist and you're doing an experiment, the more variables that are in the experiment, it's harder to know which one's helping, right? Or which one's actually changing the swing. So here's the most unique swing I've ever seen. The guy told me, he comes up and he says, hey, I don't even think I want the lesson. I've never hit the ball in the air in my life. And I thought, you know, I'm trying to relax him. I said, oh, you know, have you ever hit a driver in the air? He goes, yeah, but I've never hit an iron in the air. I said, okay, so I watch him swing. And obviously, I think when you just let people know that, on average, like when you look at a tour player's swing, honestly, if we're nitpicking it to what is perfect, how many flaws does a tour player really have in their swing, honestly? Yeah, I mean, I think quite a bit. Like if you're nitpicking it, not things that I would change, I'm just saying if you were nitpicking it, you could say, oh, I could do this, 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 I would never coach that way. But you could nitpick, and I'll say this, hey, in a tour player's swing, you got 8 to 10 things that could be wrong, usually in pairs. And you, at your handicap, you might have 15, 20 things wrong. Because inevitably, you're gonna show them the swing, and they're gonna say, oh, but what about my bent arm? What about this, what about this? And it starts going in a place that is like off the charts, confusing and complicated. But if you get out in front of it first and say, hey, I know you have more than one thing to work on in your swing. I know that. I just have found from my experience that it's not going to help you progress if I give you more than too many things at one time. Does that make sense? And it gives them confidence that I'm not missing something because who plays basketball? There was this, did anyone see the Inside the PGA Tour with my brother just recently?
Yeah.
Okay, did you see that shot I shot in basketball?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Did you see it?
You sure that was a Photoshop?
That was like embarrassing. I threw it up, barely hit the rim from like 12 feet away, right? I love basketball. When I go play basketball with my buddies, they do not say, hey, boy, get deeper in your knees. Hey, more, you know, flexion in your elbow or more bend, more, you know, follow through. They don't instruct each other. When you play golf, oh my gosh. How many of us have been doing pro-ams for like charity or just our own pro-ams raising money or at events? How much do golfers talk to each other and give free advice? It's like off the charts, right? So you know by the time they come to see you, they know the 10 things they do wrong, right? And so I get out in front of that and say, hey, I know you're gonna have multiple things wrong. My eyes are trying to see the main priority. And a lot of times when you fix the main priority, it starts to fix a couple others. So this gentleman was never lying. He was not lying. He had never gotten a ball in the air. So he obviously has a right arm that's incredibly high. If you saw it from the other view, his left hand's completely rotated this way. And so he's going to do something that I had never seen before. And usually, you know, the more we teach, the better we get because we start to see more cases. You said no one's the same, right? Everyone does something different. So he's gripping it like this from a face-on view. You can see his arms like stretched out a lot further this way. It's here. So, you know, someone that has a grip like that isn't going to go back and keep the club face square. The club face would be clear out here. For the most part, they're just going to roll it open. Well, he rolls it open kind of how it should. And so he's going to come down and literally be hitting it with the back of the club. And remember, I've been humbled by the game, but that almost made me laugh. It didn't make me laugh, but I thought, holy cow. Like, I always say, hey, don't, people, I try to relax them. They say, hey, I struggle with my game. I said, don't worry, I've seen it all. I've been there, trust me, I've struggled with it. I had never seen this before. So the face automatically opens. It's so open, it's closed now? No. And then he comes down, and he's gonna hit this with the backside of the club. Right? He's gonna hit the backside of the club, so he wasn't lying. And I'm glad I didn't say, hey, no, you had to, you've hit the ball in the air, sir. I just took it for what it worth. I was like, wow, he's probably blading them all or scooping them all, right? Hits the back of the ball, you know, like that. So he ended up changing his grip and it was incredibly awkward for him, but he could get the back of the ball and he was happy. Did I change that he's like slunched over like that and all that? No, I just left it at that because what do I want him to do? I want him to hit some good shots, right? I don't want to get it to where it's so complicated where he doesn't have the enjoyment of hitting some good shots. Go ahead.
How long did it take you to get him to change his grip?
What, like how many minutes or how many times?
Yeah, how many times?
Just that time. Yeah, just that time. Yeah, and obviously I know that after he leaves me, when he goes and he's on his own, it's going to be much more difficult. I always make a video of like pictures and a detailed email of what to do, why to do it, how to do it, and so they can look back when I'm not there. But, you know, I truly believe, like, there are times during a year where you have a lesson where you're like, dang, like, and you feel completely dissatisfied, or I have, where I'm like, dang, like I didn't get them, they came saying they're hooking it, and I didn't get them to hook it less enough, you know, or I didn't get them to straighten that out. Now I know that once I help them in that lesson, sure, they gotta go out and they gotta put repetitions in, and there's gonna be reverting back to old tendencies, but, you know, by and large, if you can get someone to, he told me he never hit the ball in the air. So my whole goal, my whole mind just goes, okay, I got to get this ball in the air. That's my whole goal. That's all I'm thinking, you know? And so he was able to do that. You know, that was so foreign to him that, but a lot of times you explain in detail before they even take that swing, so it starts to make sense of why he kind of had to roll it open. When I'm seeing people swings, I'm trying to look at the main things that affect, you know, what they told me. I'm taking that information of what their tendencies is and are and what their shot is. But what, in your experience, or what is science or physics, what's shown us, what affects the ball flight? Because I'm trying to, like, teaching is, like, complicated. It's so difficult. Like, has anyone ever thought, like, dang, this is, like, the easiest thing in the world? Like, I have, like, respect for teachers. One thing I never do is I never bash another teacher because, like, I think it's, like, so hard to teach, you know. I teach tour pros that have been with other teachers. And, man, I've worked with tour pros for just 3 or 4 months, and then they're on to the next two. Like, if you never talk shit about anybody, or you never talk bad about anybody, you have that mutual respect, but it's a very hard job. It ends up exuding a lot of confidence on your end too. And it always opens the door to come back, right? How many times have we lost a student and they come back because we just kept the door open? We never burned the bridge. That happens all the time. I've had that happen a lot and you know, I'm glad. And that's just learning from experience. Out of those 100 teachers I had in 12 years, you know, there was some that when you leave them, you knew you were never gonna be able to refer to them ever again. You know, you just knew that. You felt it, you got that vibe. I got a text from one of my web.com players the other day, and it was like really cool, but he basically said, hey, I'm gonna go see so-and-so, just wanted to let you know. And I said, hey, thanks for the text, I really appreciate that. You know, you didn't need to do that, but I respect you for doing that. He said, no, I would rather just tell you, you know, I'm curious about, you know, a couple things of the equipment he has, and, you know, and I said, keep an open mind, right? What's the worst, there's 3 things that can happen. He's gonna go see this guy, and he's gonna help him. And if I care about him, if I built that relationship, honestly, what am I going to feel genuinely? If I'm confident about what I'm doing, and I know I'm not a fit for everybody, right? Sometimes it takes the pressure off of teaching is knowing that I'm not a fit for everybody, right? It doesn't work with everybody. It takes the pressure off. There's not an ego involved in it. But it's going to either help him. Number two, it's going to not help him, and he'll come back to me. Or it won't help him, and he'll go get a different opinion. And none of those 3 options are the worst thing ever, right? And so, You always try to keep that open, but what are the things that affect the golf ball?
Club face.
Okay, club face? What's that? Path?
Angle of attack.
Loft?
Speed.
Centerness of hit?
Speed.
Equipment? Right? Any club fitters here? Or they do a lot of club fitting? How much does the club affect the ball flight?
A ton,
right? The better I got at teaching, I thought, man, I got to put a team around me to where when I can tell something's off, I'm not going to tell them I'm not an expert in club fitting, right? I don't have that ego. I'm going to get someone there in the Scottsdale area that, you know, I try and experiment and see what's happening. I mean, there's so many times where it's happened to me before. I'm trying to help somebody and really the wrong piece of equipment is like killing them, right? Have you found that in club fitting a lot? Like, you guys can help players so much without doing a ton to their golf swing, right? That's what I put. So to keep it simple, in my mind, even before club face, path, angle of attack, location of hit, equipment is the low point, right? How many times do people say, man, I want to hit it like the pros, back of the ball contact, right? A swing can look great, but if they're not bottoming on the right spot, it doesn't work. So what are some of the things as teachers that you feel like allow people to have a cleaner impact? Because honestly, if you can first get someone to have a clean impact, then I think it's a lot easier. Like, yeah, and I do the same thing with the tour pros or an average golfer. When my brother came to see me, I had already known a little bit about his game because every year he'd come in and get my help, but kind of still stay with his guys. And then it got to the point where, you know, I was just like, hey, it feels weird, right? He said, we either do it or we don't. But I had known that his contact was like it wasn't on, right? He always felt like he was going to hit it a little bit heavy, right? And most of our amateurs feel like they're going to hit it heavy, or then they react, and then they stand up, or they lift up, they throw the club. What are some of the things that you feel like are the most common traits of people that catch the ball dead flush?
Bounce.
Posture. Weight shift.
Confidence.
Shaft lean. What's that? Ball position?
Hand path.
Yeah, eye hand coordination. Yeah. Okay, one thing that got said that kind of, you know, that I see a lot with really good players, not every good player I work with a tour pro that does not lean the shaft forward. And I always, you know, I always thought that, I mean, I knew that you at least got to, I mean, you can still hit it really straight even if it's not leaning forward. It's definitely going to be, he drives it really straight, but his irons kind of suffer because of it. So most people slice the ball, right? And then, you know, how many of your students slice the ball or miss it to the right? Okay, so this is the tricky thing about lag, because, you know, Tony Finau, he has like crazy amount of lag. Who are some of the tour players that have like a ton of lag?
Sergio,
right? He's a little steep on it, but is he like the flush ball striker? Like crazy flush. Who else has a lot of shaft lean? Because there's a happy medium, right? The more you lean it forward, you got to be careful, right? The more the shaft leans forward, it's going to be wide open unless something else squares it. So there's a happy medium. Some guys that have a ton of lag, they'll have a propensity to actually miss it out to the right a lot if they have too much lag. But in general, people that err on the side of too much lag as not lag, they end up catching it solid at least, okay? And so the tricky thing about teaching lag, and you know, a lot of people, you know, you talk about weight shift. I kind of look at it as well as, you know, body rotation. But if someone is already struggling with hitting it to the right, and they told me they hit it to the right, they want to fix that, and they also hit it short. So hitting to the right, and the shaft isn't even leaning forward. And so I'm like, okay, if I lean the shaft forward, which direction, and they may hit it more solid, but which direction is it going to go more? Further to the right, right? So that's the tricky thing, right? So if you're going to go down that road with a student, I'll flat out tell them that. I said, okay, look, And that's where communication comes along. When I think, if for 10 students we had, they'd probably all interpret it a little bit differently or how to do it. So if someone is coming in, they're slicing, and the shaft isn't really even leaning forward, and then I make them just lean the shaft forward, it just goes further and further to the right, which is, they told me they didn't want to slice it anymore, start it too far to the right. So to me, I think it's a little bit of a misconception. Like, there are some people that really truly do, they pull the club down, pull, and it leans the shaft forward. But that at the same time, the club face is going to project out to the right. Tony, one of my students, he comes in with a lot of lag, and he bows it pretty darn good too. And he has to bow it, right? He has so much lag. He hits it like flush. And he kind of takes left side out of play because he has so much lag. But over time, he's kind of changed the way he looks at lag, and I'll kind of show you what I mean. Here's an example where we know that lag is good, but sometimes it's like there can be too much, right? Where you know it's never going to square up, okay? Hope that didn't freeze. So when I explain lag, I'll get someone with like a straight, a longer club. It's a little more shaffling than what I'd like to see at the start, but it's just to prove a point to them. And I tell them to start off with, okay, I want you to hit some shots, kind of hip to hip, okay? And I tell them, I don't want this club to hit you on the side, but I have two ways you can't do it to not hit yourself. You can't pull your left arm forward off your body to miss you, because I could easily just go like this, right? And that would be lag with, or pull with a wide open face. And then, a shank, yeah? And then I could just pull the left arm this way and the shaft would miss me. But then I also could just get to the top and teach someone to turn their body. And I didn't pull down, but the club face comes down square and the shaft is leaning forward. Because I think when you think of lag, and a lot of times even in my career when I was thinking lag, I was trying to pull my darndest, pull the grip in. When I could have rotated my body a little bit more to keep my hands ahead. Someone moving at 100 miles an hour, if you took someone and you just tell them, a lot of times in teaching, I'll make them do it the wrong way so they can feel it, but I'll say, okay, let's swing as fast as you can, but don't open up your chest. Don't let it open up and just see what eventually happens to the club. It's going to flip no matter what. It's going to cast this way. And then you let them just start to kind of rotate their chest a little bit, or their core, and it starts to project a little bit forward. I think a lot of good drills for doing that, and it kind of revolves around tour players. They look pretty good hip to hip. There's a lot of different things going on, but get your players that don't have good contact and don't have good weight transfer or body rotation to hit a ton of shots, short as backswing as they can, and hit it as far as they can. Someone, if you make them take it back super short, they're not going to go like this to hit it. They won't feel like they can hit it anymore. If you take it back and you start to turn your body, all of a sudden you'll start to see their shaft project forward, because of the body rotation. Does that make sense? So it's almost like a power drill to them too. But that's one of the things I see is we got to know how to fix contact. What are some of the ways that you guys fix contact? You talk about ball position a little bit, weight transfer.
Make them hit super low.
Yeah, low. That's an image, right? What do most people, if I'm telling them to hit it low and I'm trying to get them to go shaftling, I'll just give them a couple disclaimers before. I'll say, okay, I want you to have reasonable ball position and I don't want your body to necessarily shift forward. I know there's weight transfer, but there's two different ways. I could just go into my left side. I can show you some pictures of that where the head's almost on the left foot and it feels like they're compressing it, but they're just getting really, really steep. But I'll even just tell them, hey, try to stay behind it a little bit with your head, but still hit it low. All of a sudden their body starts to open up a little bit. And I would tell them that. Don't just stay back with their head, but don't open up your body, because then all of a sudden just the path goes out here, it's underneath. It can't really square up. So I like that. Slicing. So basically, you look at ball cam, the low point of the contact, and then like you say, club face, we know that accounts for a majority of what the ball does. path, angle of attack, location to hit, equipment. There's just six things right there. Like, how many more like areas really are outside of that? You know, that at impact are being affected, right? And so a lot of times I have those notes, I have them with me. A lot of times I refresh myself on, and these things are always evolving and changing, right? The way we go about things, tweaking them a little bit better, or refining them, simplifying them. But that's kind of why I kind of keep a list of basically what impacts the ball at impact.
What about the opposite of that? You get a guy that can't release it if he holds on too long. He's continually blocking it instead of coming up to one and releasing it. So what about the whole long guy? It's just, you know, sure.
Well, to me, I mean, I used to would get people, and I teach a little bit. I mean, I kind of have my own, you know, feeling of like, I don't like a ton of like club face rotation. I feel like when I look at somebody that can't release it, like of course I could get them to just roll the forearms really hard, but then that's like a whole timing game. You know, it's really difficult. So to me, I'm looking at where does he kind of have to have the club face and his left wrist position at the top to be able to come down and not slice it? Because I've done that. When I was an early teacher, I actually, and still sometimes I'll do that, like to show someone how across the ball or how steep they are, I'll tell them, hey, I don't teach this long term, but I want you to close the face as hard as you can so they can see where the ball would go if it was square to the path or their angle of attack. Does that make sense? Okay, really good. Okay, so that's why we know, when we work with our students, we know they probably watch the Golf Channel all day. They look at every Golf Digest magazine, and they hear that Dustin Johnson holds it off, right? When I think hold off, I think like this. Like, you play with me, I'm thinking, okay, I'm going to take the left side out of play because I'm going to hold on. Well, that ain't going left, but this wouldn't have gone left either. You know, if I would have had my body out of the way a little bit, my hand path could have been more to the left, the face wouldn't have had to rotate as much, right? And so with Dustin, when you think about it, a lot of times this has helped me. Like, I'll just put a club in my hand, and I'll say, okay. We saw Dustin was so close, he was open, right? You just let me know when it's, like, where he is, you know? Because it's kind of, for me, it's a little awkward. Is that close to it? Okay, it's close, it's not even enough, right? Okay, how's that? And don't post this like to my Instagram, that's where I watch it. Is that still, I gotta go more.
Yeah.
Holy cow, okay? Okay, here we go. Okay, so from here, okay? If he didn't have his hands so far in front of it, and he didn't stay so far back behind it, the face would be like incredibly shut, right? But most people that we're teaching, what do they have? An open face. And so the more they pull, it's just going right and right and right. The more they hold on, you know? And so to me, when someone's slicing, because I feel like I have to get them to improve long term, like I don't just teach them just to roll the forearms or just to flick their hand. Like when you're thinking about it, there's a lot of ways to square the club, okay? You could square a club. Now it'll still slice, but when people say, hey, how many times do we get this where he says, I know what I'm doing wrong? And in the back of your mind, you're like, well, if you knew what you're doing wrong, we wouldn't even be talking today, right? You don't know what you're doing wrong, and you don't know how to fix it primarily. So he says, okay, my buddies tell me I'm coming over the top. And this is one of my theories too, and that's helped me with my teaching, is that I always assume that the player is coming with the best swing they have available to them. They have the best swing. That's the best they got until we show them a different way, right? So I told you I was an inquisitive kid. And still, I'm always asking why. And this helps my students. They'll say, okay, boy, I come over the top. Okay, I can't stop coming over the top. And I tell them, okay, you don't want to stop coming over the top. Okay? I've had players that have told me they want to stop coming over the top. really, honestly, if they were this cupped and this open and they dropped it in the slot, that ball would go further or less to the right? Huh? It would just go more right. It would be a push slice instead of like a hole slice, right? It would be a worse result. And golf is a really athletic sport. It used to like offend me when Happy Gilmore came out. And I'm like, man, golf's a sport. Quit making fun of it. Or, you know, they didn't make it seem like a sport, right? The more you teach, you realize, holy cow, like athleticism really helps, right? There is a limit to how good a player can get without some eye-hand coordination within some athleticism, right? They're on tour, even though some of them may not look like great athletes, man, they got incredible eye-hand coordination. A lot of them play basketball, you know, tennis, swimming, ping pong. They're good at other sports. So I try to tell them, hey, you don't want to stop coming over the top. I get it. Your buddy's telling you you're aiming left. Well, if you aim square and we don't fix the next thing of why you had to start aiming left in the first place, it gives you a worse result. And I think once that makes a connection with them where they're like, they're doing the best they can. Like, I had a girl on the LPGA, she'd won 3 times, and she came to see me, and I said, you know, you're steep with your driver. And she's like, I'm not steep on it. TrackMan says that I'm swinging up on it. And, you know, I use TrackMan once in a while. I don't use it a ton, or I haven't in the last 5 years a ton. I use it more and more. As I understand it a little bit more, and I use it for different needs. But this girl was so far in front of the ball, but yet the TrackMan number was showing she was hitting up on it just because of how much she was letting go of the, you know, adding loft, basically. I mean, I could call it casting, I could call it scooping, I could call it adding loft, I could call it squaring it, you know. Her number said that she was not steep. So the whole time, she was trying to get steeper and steeper. So in her mind, steeper was more path to the left, maybe get more in front of it, right? And it just kept on hurting and hurting and hurting. She couldn't understand why she was still hitting it to the right or hitting it really short, right? And so I think a lot of times, you know, when you're talking about how you help someone that's hitting it to the right or stop holding on to it, I would look first primarily club face, okay? When you think of someone that can't, you know, I'll look at a swing, like my brother, even like right before the PGA, and he played good at the PGA, he took third. His face was like plenty square coming down, but he was hitting it to the right. So what did I know in my mind? Without having the TrackMan there, in relationship, his face was coming down. His swing kind of changed from going, you know, kind of open coming down to where he had the face a little bit more down to the ground. But he was still kind of missing it to the right. And I'm thinking, man, that's plenty square enough to hit a draw. His path was just a little too far left to where the face was still. I would not ever tell you, hey, that's an open club face coming down. But at impact, it was open to his path. And so it's like, okay, Dan, that's, you got a plenty square enough face. Your path has got to get a little bit more out to the right, and there's a lot of different ways you can do that, you know, a lot of factors. But by and large, if someone comes to me, and how many of you use TrackMan? How many have one? Okay, I love using it when I can. I'm getting my new one in a week. I'll use it more and more, keep learning about it. What have you found that's helpful about TrackMan? Now, the hard thing is, like, and I'll show you a picture where my brother, when I first started working with him, I already knew I was a bad driver of the ball because I was steep. My brother was really struggling with his driver, and I said, hey, I was kind of pushing his buttons. I said, hey, you're steep. And I knew his answer. He's like, well, bro, I'm actually level on it, you know? And I kind of showed him what I meant. Like, a TrackMan won't read, like, steep, you know, Enzo, that has all the high-speed camera, will show everything that's happening the whole time. TrackMan's reading an impact, you know, the best it can. Right? So someone could be, you know, steep, 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 and then all of a sudden lean back or throw the club and it could read that it was shallow, you know? Or, you know what I mean, the angle of attack. What have you found? What have you liked about TrackMan? I'm a big believer in being able to measure progress. TrackMan, I mean, you've got distances, you've got angles of attack, you've got, you know, path and face. There's a lot of great things there. But a lot of us don't have it, right? Like, I've been teaching tour pros for 4 or 5 years without it, and using it to make points when I like was like, man, my brother needs to know that, yes, he's level on TrackMan, but he's steep, 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 and then he has to do all these things to shallow right down at the bottom, right? What do you find, you know, helpful with TrackMan, some of the numbers?
I just think it gives me another set of some information, yeah. You know? Some
numbers. For sure.
And a lot of students, they like to see that, you know, and then we develop a baseline.
Yeah.
And, but you're right, though, it doesn't give you everything.
No.
But it's helped me, you know, maybe I had some questions that I didn't quite know what they were doing at Impact, or I couldn't see it, and it sort of give me some ideas
right.
that I could work with.
Right.
And, you know, it's just, I just think it's made you better, just more aware.
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
Of a lot of numbers I didn't used to know.
Right.
Spin rates, things like that.
Yeah.
And it's good for fitting.
Oh, incredible. Yeah, incredible for Disney. There's tons of guys on tour. They use it. I'm getting it to help Tony a little bit with these wedges. He hits it a mile, but he doesn't like to practice on the range because, you know, I'm not a huge believer in like super long sessions. There's like a point of diminishing returns. The tour pro will sit out there for 3 or 4 hours. They're willing to do it, but like it becomes like a little bit like you're losing the margin of a return. But with a TrackMan, he can sit there and hit yards up, you know, shots on the range, and be like, oh man, that was a little punch shot. That's going this yardage. Or you can match up feels to it. I mean, there's a lot of ways that people use it. But here's what I want to show you. Like, so without TrackMan, I'm going to show you kind of where I started with my brother. You know, he played really well in the majors. Took 8th at the U.S. Open. Had the low round at Oakmont, and he ended up you know, taking 3rd at the PGA. So he kind of attributes that to better driving. When I first started working with him, like full time, about a year and a half ago, I kind of just pushed these buttons. I said, you're steep, you know? And he came back and said, I'm not steep, you know? He didn't say it like a jerk, you know? Like, just, I was going, we were going there, right? So to me, come on, baby, turn around. Let's turn around, where's Brian? Oh, here we go. We're back in business. Kind of? Okay. So this is him on the beginning, okay? He's just been through some different instruction for 4 or 5 years. Everyone has their different theories, okay? In my opinion, he wasn't steep at Impact, okay? He was missing the ball to the right, though, okay? So you watch what he has to do right before Impact. And so he's trying his dangest, and I know that people end up tilting further away from the target, you know, and their heads are a little further back on good drivers of the ball. But that is a lot of movement to try to shallow it out, okay? So basically, when I first started to help him, and feeling real, I'm always using a camera nonstop, and I'll tell him, hey, I'm not using the camera to be self-conscious. They already know I don't want to be a perfectionist, that I don't want to be like that. I'll say, okay, Dan, I don't want you to feel like, you know, your spine is just still tilted a little bit away from the target. And in truth, you're only supposed to have a certain amount of tilt anyway, just based on, in my opinion, you've got, unless you're trying to hit a different shot or create a different path, the right hand, if someone takes the grip, is underneath the left a certain amount. And that's basically how much the right shoulder is going to be under it, you know, on most shots. And then it will appear to be even more as the ball's up, and then you put a little bit more weight on the right side to maybe be more level or up. But when my brother went from being, crowded space, but he's really into his left side, right? He's really forward, okay? When I told him to put a little tilt on it, he still looked like this. Like, it took him a long time. Like, does anyone, like, maybe that's a little too much tilt, but anyone look at that and think, like, that's a crazy amount of tilt?
No.
Like, not crazy, right? Nothing crazy. That's a Ferrari?
That's a Ferrari.
Don't say what that was.
Yeah, no, that's Volkswagen.
That's me in the bush. That's me in the bushes, right? But why? Like, when someone fears right, and this is what helps us as teachers, if we've played and we've had failures, why do you think someone starts to, like, lean into the left if they're missing it high right? Like, what's the subconscious mind, or what's your instincts? The more I lean into it left, I'm going to be able to somehow like keep it a little bit lower, so it's not going to be this embarrassing shot that's high right. You know, but in reality, the reason why it's going high right is the face is open to the path, and then the amount of spin could be a lot of the angle of attack as well. Okay, so right there, on the first one, TrackMan was reading that he's level and all is great, but if you looked at me and I'm trying to, and everybody does it different. Robert Stripp, he just played with Tony last week in Napa. he is so far behind the ball when he hits it. He's a great player, great ball striker. And he matches it up, because if I start here, and all of a sudden, my face can be perfectly square at the top. Is that pretty square? Close, I mean, the square, so that's a loaded term too, right? But is it reasonable within parameters? If I move my head back, is the face opening or closing? If I just do that independently, it's opening, right? Robert Streb squares it back up because he has his left wrist like incredibly bowed at impact. My brother's not a bower. That's not in his DNA, okay? He doesn't bow on the way down. I'll say that, okay? So when he set up like this, he looked a little into his left side. He's drawing all his irons, but he can't figure out why he's, you know, blocking away to the right. He's here, but by impact, you saw he's here, and then all of a sudden he's here. The face is going to be wide open. And he's not a bower, so there's nothing he can do. So to kind of help him change his swing, I'll show you face on and down the line. But his setup's like dramatically different. And for him, it seems like all my students, they feel pretty comfortable with me. So they're like, oh yeah, coach, it feels great, you know? It feels awesome, you know? They're like that. And I'm like, okay. So you take the picture out, and you just get it to be okay. And I'll talk out loud in the video when I make the reviews. I started seeing a pattern when I first started teaching. I make these reviews and say, okay, and I'll just talk into it. I just do it simply. I talk into the camera roll and say, okay, Dan, so first thing, you know, I'm going to tell him what to do, why, how, what, you know, hey, Dan, I want you to tilt a little bit. Why? Because you're having to tilt really late in the swing. How are we going to fix it? We're going to add a little bit of tilt to the setup. I found that when I'd send pictures, like, they wouldn't believe that that was, like, the change. Like, they'd be like, oh, no, I'm not. Like, that one wasn't the extreme one. Like, you forgot to send me the one that was like that, right? And so I'll talk out loud into the video, say, okay, Dan, so does this feel like a lot of tilt? And he'll answer and say, yes, this feels like a lot of tilt. So when he watches it, he looks at that and thinks, holy crap, that felt like a lot of tilt to me. Does that make sense? And I'll just talk in the video, get them to confirm that they're feeling an exaggeration, but it's looking like that. Does that make sense? So when they look at it, they're like, holy crap, I can exaggerate that, and I'm not even on the other side, the other spectrum. Okay, so, you know, right here, think of even because of how much he is into his left side, when you think of power drivers of the ball, where's their head at impact? Their head. It's back. It's way back. Dustin Johnson, way back. Tony, way back. It's a great way. As long as someone's head isn't back and they're not adding loft, that's going to be a power position, right? And a lot of times by helping someone stay back, it actually starts to project them to have their hands a little bit more forward. You know, it's through a process if you explain it. But so all of a sudden, he looks like his head is, it's almost on the left side of him, right? Wouldn't you agree? A lot of times I'll draw a line down from their right ear and just see if it comes kind of close to their right heel. It's a decent reference point. Everyone's a little bit different. I don't deal in absolutes for sure, but some general frame of mind, you know, baselines. I'll also sometimes put a mirror right underneath their right foot there to where they can see if it's shifting forward and then coming back. I'd rather just see it just stay back on their driver. So we're going to see the head position and then a little bit of the spine. And I know the spine changes throughout the swing. I'm not saying it doesn't. But my brother here is so much more behind the ball that by the time he hits it, like, how much really has the angle of his body changed? You see what I mean? And on this one, and I think I'm putting that pretty kindly. It's pretty generous. This one's really, he's leaning even more further back just to compensate for being steep, shallow, right? So if we do have the chance to use TrackMan, because I think sometimes, and we have to be who we are, like I am getting one, I have used it. I use it to make points. I think it's an incredible device, but a lot of us don't have it. So how do we gauge like steepness without having those you know, devices? A lot of times you can see it, but there's images for players, okay? Here's an image of Louis Oystese, and I think it's awesome to kind of help, because if I say to a student, hey, you're steep on your driver, you need to shallow it, like that could mean like five different things. Like, like this, I already told you, this actually does shallow it, right? It adds loft, helps you square the face, right? So that's like sometimes people hit it so short, and it, to fix their slice, they do add loft. It helps, you know, when you see someone's wrist go like this, it's doing, I'm always asking my mind, okay, what do they do? What purpose does that serve? Not that it's good or bad, just what does this do? That adds loft and it squares the face. Like, I'm not even thinking of it as a good or bad, and then I'm thinking, okay, I have to get them, if I ever want them to get out of adding loft and doing this with their wrist to square the face, I have to obviously have the club face in a much different position to where if they did that same thing, it would go where? Dead left. You know what I mean? If I've had the club face come in a different position coming down. So here's an image, because we've got to be able to help people drive the ball better. I stopped playing for a living because I stopped. I couldn't drive the ball anymore. I still could hit irons, you know, different angle attack. I understand that now, why I can kind of trap the ball on the ground, can't do it with the driver. But here's a great image of people that are struggling with, you know, because I feel like sometimes when you're talking, like, I prefer images, and I prefer put people in positions, and then using verbal. You know, because you think of like how people learn. They say, you know, picture's worth a thousand words, and a lot of times it is, okay? So to me, you look at, this is an image of Louis Oosthuizen, okay? So the ball, he's about 2 feet from hitting the ball, right? I mean, a foot and a half, I don't know. What does that look like, a foot and a half, 2 feet maybe? It's just on his right foot, right? So instead of saying, hey, because the people were, I find that like instruction, like the student doesn't want to feel embarrassed. They don't want to feel like they don't know what you're talking about. You know, so a lot of times they just go along with it. You know, you always have to be saying, okay, do you understand it? Or like you said, hey, show me what shallowing it means to you. That's a great thing. Hey, John, show me what, or Wendy, show me what shallowing it is to you. And they may go like this, and then you may think, okay, that is shallowing it, but it's also open in the face. And let me show you how, you know, here's another way of shallowing, right? So Louis comes into the ball, teed up, and by the time it's at his right foot, not because he's casted it, right? He's behind it, and the club's damn near on the ground at his right foot. So where is it going to be going eventually if it's almost on the ground at his right foot? It's going to be going up, you know, unless he's doing something or she's doing something crazy after that point. Rory, have anyone seen his swing slow down, how close the driver gets to the ground early? Like, it's crazy close to the ground, okay? So here's the images I would show someone for shallow. So he's shallow, but the hands are still ahead, right? He's not shallow because he's letting go of the loft. And that's working up, and that image for somebody can be pretty powerful, you know? And usually for a slicer, when you first get them shallow, where's the ball gonna go? If you didn't fix the open face, further and further and further and further to the right. But you just be honest with them. You say, okay, I'm going to get you shallow. And before they even do it, so that you still have their trust, that this ball should go dead right. You know? And then we'll have a reason not to have an open face. You do not want a square face if you're coming into the ball like this. If you come in with a square face, the ball will drive into the ground. When I told that girl that it won on the LPGA, she started getting spooked because in the Solheim Cup, she hit a shot high and right. Like when you first hit that first shot high and right and you haven't done it before, it's like, it's a weird feeling. But I said, hey, you would have hit it low left if the face would have been square, you know? And I'm always thinking, where would the ball go if the face was square? So when we're talking, like if you came into a lesson with me, with my juniors or tour players, I'm like using the exact same words, you know? I use the same terminology, I keep it the same. I feel like if you can explain, the more simple you can explain something, I think the more you truly understand it, actually. And it doesn't matter, like, we're in the service business, it's about them. Like, if we're talking, now some of us are going to use big words because it makes sense to us, and that's who we are, right? And that is your language. But if we're using big words to be impressive, that's not about the student. Our whole job, our student is going to think we're brilliant and we're smart if what happens? They improve. They're going to think we are a genius, whether we have a track man, whether we teach any tour pros, whether we play competitive golf, whether we have been teaching for a year, what are they going to think if we help them get better? The guy knows his stuff, right? And never lose sight of that. Like, that's some of the advice I always give to young instructors, is like, don't try to prove your value in like how much information you give. Think, if he walks away or she walks away improving, I'm brilliant to them. I'm valuable to them. They will come back. If you can help them in person, even if they go struggle, what are they going to know you can do in person? You can help them. So they're going to come back. You know, they know that, you know, as they get away from you, they're going to revert a little bit. But that's a common understanding, that it's going to be easier. But if you can't even help them in person, but you gave them all these incredible videos and you gave them all this information, these pamphlets, you gave them something, but really all they really want, they want just improvement, right? I think that keeps it really simple. We got about 10 more minutes, 15 more minutes maybe. What do you think? Five more minutes?
Five and then ask questions?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's perfect. Yeah. What time do you want me to wrap it up? 11:10?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Okay, so I'm going to show you a little bit about, so basically, like I told you, when I'm making a recap of a video, I tell people what to do, why I'm having them do it, and how. Because in the end, I don't want to just tell them what to do. That never helped me. People would say, Boyd, you're open with your shoulders. Okay. Like, and it would frustrate me, because what do I think my shoulders really are? I think they're dead square, right? A student thinks their shoulders are dead square, right? So I got to show them. I always look at teaching people that, yeah, you came to me based on like maybe a referral or trust that maybe I've helped some other players, but really, like, if you can teach players like you don't have their trust and you need to show them, like, I always, as a player, I wanted to be shown. Like, just show me. Tell me that my shoulders are open, show me my shoulders are open, and then tell me why they're open. I mean, that makes all sense to me now. They're open because the ball's going to go over here. So really, maybe fix why it's going over here, and then what am I going to subconsciously, because sometimes you can say, okay, boy, stop aiming to the left. I go over here, and I'm already hitting it 30 yards right. I feel like I'm going to hit 50 yards right now. But if you keep me over here, and you kind of get me to square the face and do a few other things, what am I going to start doing if I see that it's not tailing off to the right? What am I going to do without you even having to tell me? Start inching over there, you know? So it goes both ways too, right? I've done it where I make someone aim in that direction, and then it fixes why they have the open face and whatever, but you can go the opposite way too. Does anyone want to see kind of Tony's swing at all?
Yeah.
Okay, let's look at Tony's swing real quick, and kind of where he came from, because his story was he hadn't had instruction. He went to some really big names. He's a talented kid, super talented, but no one had really heard. Now, people had heard of him, but he had never fulfilled his like potential. It just never came about, you know? And I think it was because, you know, he's 6'4". He played basketball. He's Polynesian. He didn't have mentors in like highly technical stuff, right? So when he went to some of the world's best teachers, some of them weren't it, and they're great teachers. I've been to them. They're great teachers. But it didn't resonate with him. So when he came to me, he was kind of jaded on instruction. He was really timid, you know? When he said, hey, I'm going to come, you care if we talk? It wasn't, hey, boy, I want to have a lesson. He said, let's talk. So I'm like, I could tell he was timid. And he did some really unique things, you know? So this is where his swing is. Okay. So Tony had gripped it. And this is what I want you guys to know, is that when you're teaching, I feel like I help tour players because my bread and butter and what I love to do is help the average guy. Look at Tony's right arm. Okay, we saw the guy that already went like that, right? Will McKenzie, other players, if they have the right arm a little bit more dominant, their hands are a little more spread apart. Most people don't, you know, go out and keep it square. They end up kind of rolling the face quite a bit open. But Tony always tells me he likes feeling like his right arm is close to his body. Well, if he's already starting here, and then he got it close to his body, it's just going to be wide open, you know? So, you know, basically over time, he used to aim way to the right and cut across the ball. You can see that his right, and these are changes where, like over time, like it was really difficult for him to do. You can see that he hits a cut, and he hits a lot more of a neutral cut, almost a shallow, you know, shallow cut, neutral, almost sometimes not even the numbers being negative, okay, or the path. But you'll see, basically, and when he goes back and comes down, he's coming and he used to spin the ball a ton. So he's kind of up off his, you know, foot. Now, I'm not saying you can't come up off your heel, okay? Because Justin Thomas comes off his heel, but his left hip's still clearing this way. So he's really not, you know, humping the golf ball. But Tony right there, you can tell he's kind of humping the golf ball. So when he's pushing forward with his hips, what's going to have to come and kind of pull away? His head is, you know, he's going to have to pull away. Or his head pulls away and his hips come forward. So he's going to be a lot more out. You know, here, his hands are on the club, like, way different. And then he shallows it. I mean, he's on a completely different, you know, angle. And unfortunately, I did the update last night, but you can tell it's, you can still see where the face is there compared to where it is now. Like, that's really, really different. But I didn't make him, like, shut it. It was like the way he ended up over time being able to put his hands on it made it react a little bit more that way. So he's coming in at a different place, and you can tell his lower body action is like crazy different. So if his club face would have been behind his hands before, he would have been like stuck, I would call it, or trapped, where his arms are really far away from his body, but the club head was behind it. You know, you look at Rory and some other guys that bring it from the inside, you know, their arms, or their, you know, Tony was like this in the picture, his arms away and the club was behind him. Now he's a lot more shallow. His hips are turned a lot, but he's able to stay at his angle a lot better now. It almost looks like on the other one, he hasn't hit the ball. He's in the same spot. His right arm is so much closer to him, so much more underneath it. He is so smothered on the one on the left, right? Here's another swing real quick where he kind of started out, okay? So right here compared to where he is now. I like this swing here. This was at Bethpage in the playoffs. Really on top of it. You can see his right hand's pretty unique.
Do you teach Gipper too?
I don't. And that was just like in talking to Tony, you know, asking questions, you know. He kind of wanted me to kind of stay out of that thing, you know. Him and Gipper are good friends and close. I mean, obviously they love each other, but he was kind of like, you know, he said, hey, I prefer, you know, just stick to what we're doing, you know. And in my opinion too, I think Tony should be teaching Gipper anyway, because Tony, Gipper is incredibly talented, but Tony learned how to play somewhere along the way and Gipper didn't. And I'd rather he listen to Tony first and learn how to play, and then if he did those things, then come, you know, and be ready to do some changes, you know. Tony, one time, he said something in a magazine a little while ago, and I've matured and I've learned, but he said something like, yeah, I like working with Boyd because he's so simple. And I'm thinking, damn, that just didn't feel good to the ego. Like, I wish it sounded like so much better, like the baseline had changed, or this, and, you know, he changed this, that, and the other. And the more I thought about it, the more, like, have I been addressed by the tour pros. Like, they want, and other players, they want you to change them. Trust me, they want change. But they don't want you to change everything about them. But you can see right here, Tony at setup is really on top of it with his right arm. More open with the face. Here, he's hitting a cut, but his right arm is a little bit more under his left. His grip is different. You'll see the face is, Tony's never gonna have a super, super square club face, but for some, that's like crazy different for a tour pro. like at the top compared to where his face angle is. Like he has the whole face on the other side of the shaft on the one on the left. So the more he has it open, he doesn't cast it or add loft. He needs to de-loft. He already has the highest ball speed on tour. He needs it to come out flatter. He just needs to bow and bow and bow and square more with bowed left wrist and with pass. So you'll see he's a lot steeper on the beginning. This is him where you actually, even on the cut, he shallows it, doesn't steepen it.
Are you super particular about your camera placement?
Yeah, I mean, depending on what I'm looking for, like with Colt Nose, he likes to look at, see what is it, what it is at the top of the swing, wants to see if it's a parallel. So I'll face him right in front of his chest and I'll put it at the height of what parallel is. But
right here, would you go?
I'm a little bit different on here. I'm going on this one, I'm shooting down his perceived target line, but he was so across the ball, his body lines are way to the left, so the camera angle is going to look a little bit different. But when I would film him at times, I didn't want to go on that other side to where it would look like, it would give him the perception it was a lot more on plane than it really was, because like when you're working with like a track man, it's tricky, everyone has their opinion, when you're using a track man, you set it up to the target, and based on where that person has his or her body lines, like that track man doesn't know. And so when I would film him, I'd say, Tony, where are you going? And I'd go right through his hands on the line where he perceived the target, so that he could truly see the path and relationship to his target. Does that make sense? And so those are like really, really, really different positions right here. Different footwork too. I mean, this one, honestly, what does it look like he's gonna do on the left? Now he doesn't, it looks like he's gonna hit the hosel because it's so tough to end, you know? So these are big changes. Look how much closer his right arm is to him. He's a lot shallower, but these changes are over like 2-3 years, not over one lesson. And I think that would be what I encourage you is build a relationship with people. Do it one step at a time. You will see big gains in people's swings over a lengthy time, but don't try to perform that miracle lesson. It's exhausting as a teacher, like it leaves you deflated. I've been there. Keep it as simple as you can or organized as you can. I really appreciate, you know, all the activity, all the participation today. You know, I always, Tony, being a minority, BJ kind of has taken him under his wing a little bit, and BJ will, you know, give him some advice, and he always said, hey, when you're talking to people or learning, try to learn one or two things. Like, that was cool to me, because I'm like, okay, that's what I want to do as well when I teach, but I hope that you'll learn maybe one or two things, maybe a different way of saying things, maybe a different, I don't want to get totally into technique, because like even the people that I teach with in my facilities, like I let them teach the way they teach. I may just help them with the way they communicate, some of the visuals, some of the organization, because I don't think I have it all. I just think that hopefully maybe I share something today that maybe made sense, that we can simplify things for our students. Not that the game's simple, but that they can make progress incrementally. Appreciate your guys' attention. And does anyone have a question? But we got to wrap up, right?
Yeah, a quick question if you take. Mike?
No, I can do it. Do you get plane lessons, and how long is your average lesson on average, and do you have time for plane lessons?
Yeah, I mean, I started to do that more and more. Like, I started even, like, when I worked with junior students over the years, I kind of started actually on the course. Like, because I looked at relationships as, hey, is this a fit? The busier you get, the more selective you can get. But even if you're not selective, I should have been doing that at the beginning, saying, hey, this is what I believe. Talk to the parents. I'm going to take your kid on the course. I want to see him play 2 or 3 holes. I can get to know. I thought to myself, why am I making that mistake? I've taught some kids for a year and never seen them play, you know, enough holes to really even know really what's happening. So I will start some lessons. I do like half day and full day lessons now, but for a long time I was just doing hour to hour to hour to hour, you know. And if they want to get on the course, I would just have them do an hour and a half to 2 hour lesson. But I think the time spent on the course, I mean, it's kind of, I feel like it's evolved more into that for me. Get my iPad out there, see their game, you know, because a lot of times if there's teaching and there's coaching, the coaching aspect is being able to see something they didn't see. Not even that it's negative. Sometimes they have a skill that you never even knew they had because you've only seen them on the range. And you're like, holy cow, this kid or this girl, this person is really good at this skill. Man, I think I can build a game around that one skill they have, you know? So I think the more you get your students on the course, you know, the better. And most people, honestly, what do they tell us anyway? What do they have a hard time doing? Taking what from the range to where? The range to the course, so go to the course. If they can be hitting, and I'll do that with a lot of practice sessions where I teach, there's both places I teach, there's a place where you can go hit a couple holes, it's not busy. If I feel like they've gotten the message, I'll go, hey, let's go put it on the course and go see how they react out there. And I think that when they hit good shots on the course, then they really know they're onto something, because you know the range is a little bit different, the repetition, the time in between shots. But yeah, I encourage all people to get into playing lessons. I just view it as like, it's just your time anyway, you know? So that's giving me as a coach or a teacher the best chance to help them. So I actually push pretty hard for on time, you know, lessons.
You mentioned your struggles when you were tinkering with your swing and so forth. What is your brother's mentality with this game?
Yeah, you know, right along with what you guys are saying, you got to know your client. We both came from the same father. My dad is obsessed with the game, and he has a new swing thought every hole, right? And so when my brother starts to get going that direction, you know, we even have this experience right now. He hasn't been playing great of late, right? He played incredible at the majors and played good right after the PGA, and he's kind of struggling, right? And as a coach, you know, if someone plays bad for 1 week, 2 weeks, there isn't really much to say. They just took third in a major, right? Like, that's, I'm not going to panic and not say too much. But eventually you have that conversation, say, hey, Dan, are you wanting to change this because of perfectionism or because of function, right? And so, yeah, I mean, you know your certain students that kind of have that moxie, like, hey, if you get me to hit that tight draw, coach, I don't even really need to see it. Like, I'm okay. And then there's some students that need to see everything, and that's who they are, and you're going to need to let them be the way they are, but you kind of got to also, you know, be true to who you are too. You know, I got to steer, you know, certain students away from going down that road, because all of a sudden, like, it starts to get really, really complicated. But I'll just flat out ask. Just say, hey, are we doing this out of function or out of, you know, chasing perfection? You know, I always say, don't chase something that doesn't exist, you know. Awesome. Thanks so much, everybody.